Hello students, welcome once again in the video lecture series designed for you students of class 12th. Today we are going to start a new chapter, Production and Cost, of the first book, Introductory Microeconomics. In the previous chapter, we have discussed the behavior of the consumers. In this chapter, as well as in the next chapter, we shall examine the behavior of a producer. Actually, the task of a producer is to produce the goods and services to satisfy the demand of the consumers. What activity he does is termed as production. So, first of all, we should know the meaning of production. Generally, production is defined as an economic activity which produces material goods and services or which increases the value of commodities already produced. Production is an important activity because the performance of an economy is judged by the level of its production. Those countries which produce goods in large quantities are rich, and those which produce little of them are regarded as poor. Therefore, the USA is a rich country because its level of production is high. India is not so because its level of production is low. In economics, by production, we mean the process by which man utilizes or converts the resources of nature to make them satisfy human wants. Actually, any activity which adds or creates utility is termed as production. Production includes not only creation of material goods, but rendering of services also, because like physical goods, services also satisfy human wants. It should be noted in this regard that production should not mean as creation of matter, because man cannot create matter. Only thing the man can do is change the form of matter. Now, this utility may be creation of form utility, as changing the form of a log of wood into a table. Or utility may be creation of place utility, as extraction of minerals from earth. Or it may be time utility, as storing of seasonal fruits to make them available during off season. Utility may also be in the form of personal utility, as making use of personal skills as of merchants, organizers, etc. Actually, production is the combined efforts of four primary inputs known as factors of production: land, labor, capital, and entrepreneur. Even a small piece of bread cannot be produced without the active participation of all these four factors of production. While land is a free gift of nature, the human endeavor is classified functionally and qualitatively into three main components, namely labor, capital, and entrepreneur. Let's throw some light on the meaning of these four factors of production. First among them is land. Land refers to all natural resources which are free gift of nature. It includes both on the surface and under the surface. Examples of land are soil, river, water, forest, mines, desert, sea, climate, etc. Land is a passive factor, that is, it is immovable. Its supply in economy is perfectly inelastic, means supply of land cannot be changed from the economy's point of view. It cannot be created nor destroyed by the man. Land alone can produce nothing. Second factor of production is labor. Human efforts done mentally or physically with the aim of earning income is known as labor. The compensation given to laborers in return for their productive work is known as wages. Labor is an active factor of production. Land and labor are also known as primary factors of production. Actually, it is labor which in cooperation with land makes production possible. You should remember that labor is an exception to the law of supply. as wages of labor increases and increases, it wants to supply less hours for production. Generally, it is said that labor has poor bargaining power because it is in an economical weaker section of the society. Generally, it is said that employers exploit the laborers, but it is not so in the modern age. Third factor of production is capital. Students, can you answer whether capital is a part of wealth or wealth is a part of capital? I mean to say that which of the two between wealth and capital is a broader concept? Yes, you are right. It is capital which is a part of wealth and not vice versa. Wealth includes your buildings, land, assets, bank balance, cash in hand, investments and much more. But capital is only that part of the wealth which you take out and invest in your business. Means it is clear that wealth is a broader concept than capital. Capital is a man-made material source of factor of production. All man-made goods which are used for further production of wealth are included in capital. Or we can say that all man-made tools to production which are not consumed for their own sake are termed as capital. It will be right to say that capital is the produced means of production. Examples of capital are machines, tool, buildings, roads, bridges, trucks, etc. Logically, capital is derived from land and labor and has therefore been named as stored up labor. Capital formation includes three stages. Firstly, savings, which depends on our income and also on our willingness to save. Second stage in capital formation is to mobilize these savings. And third stage is investment. Investment means addition to the stock of capital goods, such as buildings, equipments, that adds to the future productive capacity of the economy. Now, the last fourth factor of production is entrepreneur. An entrepreneur is a person who organizes the other factors of production. He coordinates the land, labor and capital in right and required proportion to use them for production. Actually, entrepreneur is the person who initiates the business and undertakes the risk and uncertainty involved in the production. This risk may be financial risk or technological risk. His main function is innovation. As we saw that a producer or a firm acquires different inputs and combining these inputs, it produces output. In order to acquire inputs, it has to pay for them. This payment is nothing but the cost of production. Once the output has been produced, the firm sells it in the market and earns revenue. The revenue that it earns net of cost is the profit of the firm. We assume here that the objective of a firm is to maximize its profit. A producer wants to produce that amount of output such that its profits reaches the maximum. For this, we have to understand the technical term production function. Actually, the production function means the physical relationship between the units of input and output. If the units of input are given to the producer, he tries to maximize his output by using the given input and given state of technology. And if level of output is given to him, he tries to minimize the quantity of input. A production function is defined for a given technology. It is the technological knowledge which determines the maximum level of output that can be produced using different combination of given inputs. Because if the technology improves, the maximum level of output obtainable by different input combination may increase. And then we will have a new production function. The inputs that a firm uses in the production process are called factors of production. we assume that a firm uses only two inputs for producing output, and these are labor and capital. Therefore, we may write the production function as Q equals to function of x1, x2. It means that by using x1 amount of factor 1 and x2 amount of factor 2, we can produce Q amount of the commodity. Q means quantity of output, which is a function of two inputs x1 and x2. The production function works behind three assumptions, which are: first, it is related to a particular unit of time. Second, the technical knowledge during that period of time remains constant. And third assumption is that the producer is using the best technique available. Students, do you remember that we have learnt about indifference curve in the previous chapter? The indifference curve shows the same level of satisfaction by consuming different combinations of two goods. And that indifference curve was for consumer. Here we are introducing a similar concept known as isoquant. It is just an alternative way of representing the production function. Basically, isoquants are similar to indifference curves of the theory of consumer behavior. An isoquant shows all the different combinations of two factors which give same level of output. Isoquants are also called as equal product curve because they give equal level of output, or they are known as isoproduct curve because iso means same, or isoquants are also known as constant product curve. Since an equal product curve represents all those combination of inputs which gives equal quantity of output, the producer is indifferent between them. That's why another name for an isoquant is production indifference curve. The concept of the isoquant can be easily understood with the help of the following table. In this table, we have four columns. First column is for combination of two factors. Second column shows units of factor 1, third column shows units of factor 2, and last column is for marginal rate of technical substitution, in short known as MRTS. We can see combination A shows that producer is using 1 unit of factor 1 plus 12 unit of factor 2. Combination B shows that factor 1 is used by 2 quantity and factor 2 is used in 8 units. Combination C shows that 3 units of factor 1 are used and 5 units of factor 2 are used. And combination D shows that the producer is using 4 units of factor 1 and 3 units of factor 2. Students, remember, we are doing isoquant curve, and these all 4 combinations give same level of output to the producer. Last column, marginal rate of technical substitution, we will discuss later. If we draw a curve using two columns of factor 1 and factor 2, what we get is nothing but isoquant. Isoquants have properties similar to the indifference curve. Like indifference curve, isoquants are downward sloping from left to the right due to the inverse relationship between the two axes. Inverse relationship means if we have to increase the quantity of one factor, then the quantity of the other factor has to be reduced, only then they can give same level of output. Let's discuss the properties of isoquant. Number 1, it is downward sloping from left to right. Number 2, it is convex to the origin due to declining marginal rate of technical substitution. Here I would like to tell you that marginal rate of technical substitution means as we increase the units of one factor, the rate of sacrificing the units of second factor goes on diminishing. Third property is that two isoquants can never intersect each other as they give different level of output. because if they intersect each other, it would show that at intersection point, two isoquants are giving same units of output, which is impossible. Fourth feature of isoquant is that higher isoquant gives higher units of output. Its next property is that isoquant can never touch either axis, because if it touches x axis, it means the units of vector y are 0. And if it touches the y axis, it means that units of vector x are 0. And the units of any factor cannot be taken as 0, because only one factor cannot produce without the help of the other factor. Next property of isoquant is that it can neither be horizontal to the x-axis nor vertical to the x-axis. This is so because if it is horizontal to the x-axis, it means that units of factor y are constant, and we are increasing the units of factor x continuously, but the units of output obtained are constant as one isoquant shows, but it is impossible. Same case will happen if isoquant is vertical to the x-axis. For understanding the concept of production function more clearly, we shall go into the short run and the long run. In our next lecture, we will do the production function in short run and long run and relevant laws applicable in the respective period. Let's revise what we have done today. Today we did detailed meaning of production, various inputs used in the process of production, and the concept of isoquants. So, thank you. Till our next lecture.